Ladies and gentlemen, fellow Christians and friends, Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship, our virtual hour of worship is now streaming live. We thank you for tuning in. We come to you each and every Sunday at 3:30 p.m. On this evening, we thank you for tuning in, even though we had technical difficulties, but we are still going forth praising the Lord. We invite you to stay tuned and to share this hour on your Facebook timeline. Again, we thank you for tuning in with us. for Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship, our virtue worship. We want to thank you for tuning in, even though we normally start at 3:30 p.m., but we had technical difficulties, and I want to thank you in spite of that you share with us on this evening. Why don't you take out the time to share this hour on your Facebook timeline? And in the background, as we wait on the other viewers to come on in, it's a new season, it's a new day. It's a new season. How many feel like giving God some praise? God has been so good to us. Come on, we ought to lift holy hands. Since you all stopped by, we might as well praise him just because you woke up this morning. Somebody didn't wake up. You ought to lift up holy hands. Magnify the Lord for his goodness. Hallelujah. Can we praise him? Can we praise him? Oh God. Oh God. Wherever you are, even if you're in your house, in your living room, lift your hands up to the Lord. Just because he is a God of supernatural blessings. Hey. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say, you're my God. All together. Hey, glory. Adiós. Thank you. Come on, let's worship. Let's worship him just because. Just because he's worthy. He's wonderful. You ought to give him all the praise. Hallelujah. It's just nice to stop and give God some praise. God inhabits the praise of his people. Our scripture for the evening, the 91st number of the Psalms. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. In him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wing shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. And the word of God is already blessed. That God be glorified, Satan be horrified, and the word be edified. Let us pray. Let us pray. Every head bowed. Name Jesus. We lift up holy hands right now. We come to you just to give you the praise, just because you are worthy. And for your glory, Master, we will do anything just because you woke us up this morning, because you gave us another opportunity for life, Master. We thank you right now because you are Jehovah God, because you are Jehovah Jesus, Jehovah Rapha. You're Jehovah Elohim. You're the first to the last, ending and beginning. Master, you are my friend. And because you're my friend, Master, I don't come begging, grumbling, nor complaining. Thank you, because you've been good to us. You kept us. You brought us another week, another worship experience, to give us the opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. So we lift up holy hands right now. We come to Shabbat you. We come to celebrate you, because you are of your excellence, because of your majesty, because of your holiness. Because of your power, because of your power. Now, Lord, touch us tonight. Give us a word for your people. Send down your latter rain. Let it fall fresh on somebody tonight. Let yokes be destroyed, strongholds brought down, deliverance go forth, and somebody might come crying, "What must I do to be saved?" Oh, God, we need you right now. There's sickness all over the land. There's disease, Master. And so right now, we come before you, not begging you, but you're the only hope that we know, Master. So We leaning, we trusting, depending, because you said you would supply our every need. You said we could cast our cares upon you because you care for us. So, Father, you also said you would not let your word come back void, but accomplish those things it set out to do. So we call it on your name right now. We binding Satan on every hand, cancel and denounce right now every assignment of the enemy. In the name of Jesus, we shall live and not die. Touch right now in the mighty name of Jesus and bring healing in the land. Lift up bow down heads. Encourage our spirits. Those of us that got sickness in our family. Those of us who have lost loved ones. Those of us that are confused. Those of us, Master, that just need a touch. Been waiting on you all day just for a touch. Touch right now. I know you can. I know you will, Master. You got all power in your hand. Oh, God. In the name of Jesus, send down your power. Cover us and shield us with your blood. Use us in a mighty way on tonight that you would be glorified. We offer up this prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. We decree and we declare. And we offer up this prayer. To God we give the glory. We give you the glory. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Excuse me. Ain't it just nice to magnify the Lord? Isn't it nice to just give him some praise because he is worthy? God bless you. I'm so happy to have y'all to come and share with us on tonight. Apostle Miles and Dr. Apostle Angela Walker, all of you all that just stopped by. It's just nice to be nice. Amen. We so happy to have you share with us. As I said earlier, the Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship, our virtual worship, we convene each and every Sunday at 3:30. On today, we had technical difficulties, and that's the reason we had a late start. But I want to thank God for each of you, in spite of, for sharing with us. Amen. Eartha Lumsey, God bless you and your family. Evangelist Monica Body, Henry Warfield, and Sister Cynthia Turner from Sweet Holy Spirit, Rose Marie Eggleston, and my good friend LaShawn James. God bless you. Love you. Amen. My cousin Lenora Thompson, Evelyn Yancey. Amen. And then we have Pastor Bryant Skinner Jr. We want to congratulate you. Amen. We have not been able to come and congratulate you. I don't know when your installation is going to be, but we're praying that God is going to get us through this. But we have to be patient. We can't rush it. Amen. We got to listen to the voice of God, not the voice of the media and all these different folks. And I'm just so happy for you, Pastor Bryant. Let us celebrate Pastor Bryant Skinner. Amen. Who is a new pastor in the city of Chicago. Amen. So we celebrate you on today. And Jacqueline Calico, she always stopped by. Amen. So happy to have you and happy to have, amen, amen, Erica Williams, Apostle Lillian Carter, Apostle Lillian, all these great apostles and pastors, Pastor Dr. Quentin Forrest, our friend and brother, Dr. Charles Neal, so many of you, Dr. William G. James, Lisa Valentine, Amen. We just, all of you are Apostle Dr. Michael Hoggett Sr. Amen. We're happy to have you, my cousin Henry Warfield. I just like, it's just nice to be nice. So before we go, Pastor Edward Jones Sr., thank you, Apostle Sally. We tuned in to you earlier, and I really enjoyed, amen, what God was saying through you on today. All these very fine bishops, Bishop Avery, how do you say that? Comitia, I hope I said it right. I haven't had the pleasure. Who we got here? Tara Conway. God bless you, Tara. God bless you. It just so many of you are. You know what? I want us to double this number today. Everybody that's on here, if you would share, God bless you, Pastor Charles Redman, and who is that? Sharon Ferguson, all you all that stopped by. Every one of you, I need you all, because we was late today. I need you all to share this, because we probably lost some folk. Amen. And we want to get, we're not going to hold you long. Amen. We're going to get into our lesson for today. I just want to say this to the body of Christ, to our faith community. Amen. God is a great God, and he have given us what we need as the people of God. Amen. He have equipped us with sense and some common sense. I've been in church all of my life, even from a little bitty boy. I came up in the church, directing the choir, singing in the choir. I didn't miss church. I was there for Bible study. I was there on the Friday night. I was there for teachers meeting on the Tuesday night. So church is my life. I was never a gang banger or this type of personality. I've been ministry all of my life. So because I in ministry, just like a lot of us, I love ministry. I love God. I love y'all. And I want to see y'all alive. God would not have us to be ignorant concerning these things. I put it that way. And I'm speaking of our pandemic, that's the pandemic, not ours, but the pandemic, the COVID-19. We need to quit worrying about that and focus on Jesus. Amen. God allows, sometimes he allows things, just as I told you all before, with Noah. And he told Noah to stay on the ark. He didn't tell him to get off the ark. Noah sent a dove. He didn't go nowhere. The children of Israel, they stained the doorpost. They didn't come out the house so that the death angel could pass by. I just want to ask you all, because I love you. I've been in the house. I'm staying in the house. God bless you, Apostle Edison. I'm staying in the house. You and your family, wear the mask. Practice social distancing. It's not time to go back in the building. Amen. Yes, the church is. I appreciate that from Dr. Wilson, Willie Wilson. The church is essential. God bless you, Pastor Sheila Martin. The church is essential, but the church is not the building. And I'm not trying to get nobody no hard time. The church is essential, but the church is us. Amen. Until we get that, you know, I'm not dishing or knocking folks that go in the building. I just ain't going. I got too much work to do, and I'm not ready to go nowhere. And if we don't take care of ourselves, I didn't like the way that we, and I'm going to say this, I didn't like the way that I saw so many derogatory things said about Dr. Willie Wilson, because he has helped a lot of folk in Chicago. He had helped a lot of people in Chicago. He had blessed a lot of people. I don't agree with everything he says. I don't agree with everything he does. But sometimes we just need to close our mouths. Amen. We don't always agree with somebody's platform, but we got to learn how to love in spite of. Guess I was, as I was saying, down at the State of Illinois building, I was down there. But I was there to support him because of what I see him and nobody else doing in the cities and the neighborhood. And so some of y'all say, well, he got, you know, he got something up his sleeve. But then that doesn't matter. What matters is that he is blessing us. He's being a blessing. I never took a dollar from Willie Wilson. A lot of y'all had $100 bills. A lot of the pastors, y'all got $1,000 on this day and thought, I didn't get that. But I thank God I learned how to love on somebody. Sweet Holy Spirit, that's the church. Mount Vernon, that's the church. We cannot be divided. Fellowship. That's the one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And no way we gonna make it in if we can't all come together and love on one another in spite of our differences, in spite of how large our congregations are, in spite of race, creed, color, ethnicity. I love my people and I want to see you all doing well. So let us be patient. A lot is going on in our government. And a lot of us are not blind. If we listen to everything we hear on the news, we wouldn't be here. I'm trying to stay away from the hospital because the hospital is not a good place to go now. They doing too much in these hospitals. So we need to take care of ourselves to stay out of the hospitals. I'm not taking a COVID-19 test unless I get and God done told me I ain't getting sick. But y'all don't need to run and get no COVID-19 test. You just need to follow the instruction. Do we worship the building or do we worship God? God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship them in spirit and truth. If you really love your church, continue to support it. I'm just going to say that, and then I'm going to go on about my support your church collectively, financially. I hear folks fussing and fighting about because they don't want to tithe. If you don't want to tithe, don't pay that tithes. But then the same people that don't want to tithe, they always want to be up front. And I always want to have your mouth open and have something to say. Well, I'm one that believe you ought to put your money where your mouth is. Amen. And I wouldn't want to be part of something, Cynthia, that I wasn't going to support. You need to still support. I know pastors right now, it's a shame that the churches is not giving them a dollar. We still need to take care of our shepherds. We still need to take care of the building until we get back in it. We still need to pay our tithes and offering. There are so many ways, virtual ways of paying it through Zelle, Cash App, Giblify, or drop them off or mail a check to your church. I'm an apostle, amen, in the Lord's church. And when I speak, I speak internationally for the church. I don't just speak for Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship. I speak because I love God and I want us to be the church that he's calling for in this last and evil day. Amen. Let us take care of our pastors. Let us pray for our pastors. This is the first time our pastors, Pastor Skinner, this is the first time I never pastored during a pandemic. So you need to be patient with the pastor. It's difficult to stay home. I know it is. I'm seeing people running up and down the street, no masks. I'm seeing folks in the churches, no masks, no whatever. But I just want to say to you, I'll use wisdom. Be safe. Be safe. Last but not least, I talked about this the other day. there are not too many virtual worships on Facebook. We need to thank God because of Facebook, we got, and Zoom, we have an avenue to worship. So I tell folks all the time, Apostle Miles, if you don't like my peaches, don't shake my tree. I don't beg folks to listen to me. And if it's somebody you don't enjoy, just don't go around always get your mouth on somebody. Just don't watch it. They too long. They got too much music. They think they in church. You didn't know it, but we are in church. This is our church now. This is our church. This is all we have for right now. So for those of you that don't get it, and you wonder why, I had a person tell me, I think 45 minutes, 30 minutes is long enough. It might be. Then after the 30 or 45 minutes, then you get off. That's all. But see, I came from a time when I went to church at 9 in the morning and went home at 9 at night. So you don't get it. So I just want to put that out there. We either be part of the solution or we are part of the problem. Amen. There's a way that seem it right to a man, but to the end is the way of death. Amen. So be careful. Let's be positive. Let's not be grumblers and complainers and messy all the time. Let us lift up and esteem one another. All right, that's enough of that. I know y'all tired of me. I was just giving y'all time, amen, to share. I was giving you all time, amen. Me too, long hours, amen. I was giving y'all time to share this hour. I need y'all to do that. And I also need those of you that will support us by sowing, amen, into this fellowship, Hope Covenant Fellowship, Kingdom Fellowship, that the virtual ways of giving, they are posted on the video. And those of you that would like to support us, please, ma'am, please, sir, do so. All right, Cynthia says, even though the doors of the buildings are closed, we must still stay obedient and pay your tithes, Cynthia, and put down and offerings. Tithes and offering. All right, so we're going into our lesson. Those of you that got your Bibles, those of y'all that stopped by to say hello, those of you all that's ready to go, bye-bye. But we're going to go into our word. Come and go with me to the book of Ephesians 4:11-13. And it said, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Till we all, I want y'all to get this verse if you didn't get nothing now, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of fullness of Christ. We're going to talk about, amen, we are going to talk about tonight releasing apostolic activation in the church. Releasing apostolic activation in the church. Amen. Before I go further, I just saw my friend, Denedra Watson. I want to ask you all, I need a favor. My iPhone is overheating. If somebody have, God bless you, Brother Leonard, if somebody have an iPhone, amen, and you want to sell it, it's in good condition, give me a call, because that's what's been happening. My phone has been overheating. iPhone is overheating, and that's another technical problem I'm having. So if you have one you like to maybe to sow into our ministry, that's not too old now, or that you would like to sell, please contact me. Leave me a message in Facebook Messenger, or call me at 773-924-2790. I need to replace my iPhone. All right. Thank you all. Releasing apostolic activation into the church. The main purpose is to bring back spiritual order. That's what the apostolic is about. Just because there's a pandemic, we don't need to just go crazy. Amen. Amen. We don't need to go crazy. We still have, amen, to have order and structure in the body of Christ to such a measure as to cause the body to become beautiful. I'm talking about all of us, regardless if you're on the west side, north, east. I'm talking about the church when Jesus said, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And he was not talking about a building, but a assembly of people. He said, as to cause the body to become beautiful, that when the world looks at the church, they see an institution that is disciplined, ordered, beautiful, and perfect. Amen. And that's why I said what I said earlier. The church, we don't need to be messy. When we don't like what folks do, we need to quit always posting negative stuff. It's enough negativity on Facebook. We don't need to do that. We need to be an institution that is disciplined, ordered, beautiful, and perfect. We are the bride of Christ, the church. This does not mean that the apostle doesn't have the love of God, because we have that assignment to keep the order. But rather because we are so passionate about the things of God, and so we love the Lord and we love the people of God, that the reason we flow and operate the way we do is because that is the way God has gifted us. Amen. Many people misinterpret the anointing and gifting of the apostles. Amen. But apostle is just one of the fivefold gifts. And he gave some, we said, apostles and prophets and evangelists, pastors and teaching. So let's talk about the apostolic activation. Activation is to employ or to make use of someone or something that's not active to make it, or something inactive to give and assign and put it to work. A lot of us in the body of Christ, we need to be activated. When you activate it, you won't have time to be messy. When you activate it, you don't have time to gossip. When you activate it, you will pay your tithes. You won't look for excuses for not doing what's right. He said, you have robbed me, this whole nation. God said it, bring all the tithes unto my storehouse, that there might be meat in my house. Try me. God bless you, Bishop Coley. Improve me. But we fight and tithing. Why? Because the pastor not right. I'm tired of giving all these pastors my money. You're not giving money to the pastor. You give it to God. If the pastor mess it up, then he going to be in God's judgment. God going to take care of him. Jesus wants to activate the apostolic in us. See, a lot of y'all, when y'all hear say the apostolic, you think we're talking about you a Baptist church, you a Pentecostal church, you Church of God in Christ, you apostolic. No, we're not talking about that. When we speak of the apostolic in us, the fivefold, that's what we're speaking about. Amen. So happy to have First Lady Geraldine Dumas, amen, in us, because it releases dynamics and benefits. amen, that will enrich our lives. He gives us a team. I want y'all to hear this part. Bishop Townsend, Aaron Townsend, Bishop Townsend, amen, amen. He gives the church, are y'all listening to me? God gives the church a team of teachers to accomplish his goal. The church was never intended to be a one-man show. Although we do it that way. We all want to have our own kingdoms and sit on our own thrones as the Prince of Bel-Air or whatever. We want to be the poobah. But that's not... Jesus wants to activate the apostolic because of what it does. He's given us this team, amen, to accomplish his goal. Somebody ought to say amen. We call those teachers fivefold ascension gifts. Nothing that's so deep. Fivefold, which is just talking about the giftings. Fivefold ascension gift. It's extremely important to point out the gift of the apostle. Why? The apostle, and some people going to get mad at me today because what I'm getting ready to say, is listed first, and it's still only one of the five specific ascension gifts. We spend too much time arguing over who's the highest, the bishop or the apostle. Neither one. There is no hierarchy. God, when he said a bishop is a pastor. I want y'all to look at the hand. Look at the hand. Don't look at the nails. Look at the hands. Gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That was, that this hand represent the fivefold. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors. Pastors is elders. Pastors is bishops. And the Bible says if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desire a good work. Amen. So, because the prophet is here, the prophetic gift is just as important as the gift of the apostle and the evangelist, the pastors, the elder. Amen. The bishop and the teachers. Now, all these prophets, test, I don't know about that. I don't know about all the prophets, test, that y'all be talking about. I don't know nothing about that. I'm not saying it's not, but I don't have the wisdom on this prophetesses that y'all be talking about. So, in 1 Corinthians 12 and 28, it reads, and God has set some in the church first apostles. Why? Because first we need the order in the church. And it is the apostles' assignment that the church be in a certain apostolic order. Not that he's supposed to run the church. I hear a lot of pastors that's concerned that the apostle, I don't want no apostle coming taking over our church. That's not the apostle's assignment. Secondly, prophets. Thirdly, teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, governments, diversity of tongues. It's more to church than just dancing, entertaining, shouting, and speaking in tongues. When you are blessed apostolically, you have something to bring to the table. Your apostolic gift may be in construction. Your apostolic gift may be, you may be apostolically, amen, blessed in the property, you know, far as in real estate. That's what I want to say. So there are so many areas of the apostolic. It's not all about wearing a collar and a chain in your pocket. Amen. All five gifts are extremely important. And for the church to function like it ought to function, it needs all five of these perfecting of the saints. Well, let's take a look at some of the things that the apostolic might release. Amen. We know that Jesus imparted, amen, the five distinct gifts to equip his church. I said his church. Some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, pastors and teachers. Well, let's talk about impartation and activation. To impart is to give, to convey. As I'm doing today, I'm imparting, I'm giving, I'm conveying, or to grant from, as if from a store, or to communicate knowledge of something. Then to activate is to make something active, or not just active. A lot of us in church are active, but we need to be more active. And so the job of the apostle is to is impartation and to activate. We firmly believe that every person that follows Jesus has an important role. There's nobody that's left out of this team if you are part of the church of God. So you have a role to play in advancing the kingdom of God. Amen. I hope y'all getting this. God wants more than for us to simply attend a service. That's where I'm going. All our focus is on the service. All our focus is on running up and down the aisle. All of our focus is in the praise tent. And there's nothing wrong with that. All of our focus is in the Hammond organ and the drums and the but he wants to give us gifts that will help us in the mission field of daily life. When you're apostolically blessed, when you leave the church, you still can operate in the apostolic gift, whether you're in the church building or not. Come join us as we seek God and the things that God wants to give us. A lot of you that's watching me today, God wants you to stir up the gift in you. A lot of you all have gifts and gifting, but you have kind of got used to inside the building what goes on. And so during this pandemic, God is restructuring. Amen. God is resetting. Amen. He's resetting, he's restructuring, he's rebuilding, he's cleaning up his church. So when we go back to the church, we're going to see something new. That's another reason that the politicians don't understand that it's not time to go back in the building. We listening to everybody's voice, amen, except for the voice of God. God is talking to us. He been talking to us before COVID-19, Hurricane Katrina, 9/11, wars and rumors, and yet we don't get it. For I long to see you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift. That's what the apostolic does. To the end ye may be established. It's our job to equip the saints. Romans, that's Romans 1 and 11. All right, let's look at, we're just going to do some verses for a little while because we were behind schedule a little bit and I did want to share some things with you. 1 Corinthians 1 and 7, so that ye come behind in no gift. We in the church, we need to be perfected. Whatever we do in the church need to be done in excellence. We, you know, I can't stand a jacked up bootleg church or ministry. In 1 Corinthians, it said, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we should put our best foot forward. Romans 11 and 29 said, for the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. What you mean by it, mean just because you can hoop good, sing good, praise dance, that don't mean you saved, and that don't mean you got no anointing. It is the anointing that destroys the yoke. And just because you got a gift, God said they are without repentance. 1 Timothy 4 and 14, neglect not the gift that's in you, which was given thee by prophecy, with the laying on of hands of the presbytery, of the preacher. I'll make sure y'all understand. 2 Timothy 1 and 6, as we hurry along. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance. Wherefore I put thee, God bless you, Sharon, in remembrance that thou stir up. You've been in the church 40, 50, 10 years, and you still doing the same. It's time to stir up the gift of God, which is in you, by the putting, laying on of hands. Every believer is called, amen, into the work. In other words, the occupation of ministry to some degree. You're not just there to sit on the premises, but you're there to stand on the promises. God desires to give to each man and woman the gifts and talents and abilities necessary to complete their assignments here on earth. Through apostolic and prophetic impartation gifts, they are deposited into and mobilized or activated for use. Again, impartation, to impart means to give or to share a portion of, and to make known, to tell, and to reveal. Apostolic ministry, not apostolic church. Apostolic ministry, Jack Carter Jr., God bless Pastor Jack Carter, amen, has the ability to impart the gifts, the anointing, the strength, and power into the lives, amen, of breakthrough believers. I'm not just talking about the church folks. I'm actually talking about believers. Every believer should receive prophetic impartation and apostolic activation of the gifts. So what am I saying? If you are in the body, amen, it's evident that there's a gift in you that need to be activated, amen, for the perfecting of the saints, the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. Some of us got this confused. So we think everybody should be a bishop. We got more bishops than I have seen, more apostles that's not walking in the apostolic or the fivefold. Prophets, and these folks that say, I'm a prophetess, this, those people, amen. So every believer should receive prophetic impartation. And see, then you got to study. You got to read your Bible, because the Bible says it, Pastor Jack, to study to show yourself approved, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We want a pastor. We want to wear a collar, but we don't know the 23rd Psalms in John 3:16. So without impartation, the believer will lack. Y'all hear that? The believer will lack. How you gonna lead somebody where you don't go? You want a pastor, but you don't believe in tithing. Amen. So happy to have Pastor Arthur James Felton Jr. So the apostolic ministry has the ability to impart those gifts of anointing, strength, power into the lives of believers. All of us, every believer, we should have those gifts imparted and activated into our lives. Amen, Apostle. So happy to have you. Without the impartation, amen, the believer will lack, again, that which is needed to do the work of the ministry in its fullness. We'll just become folks that just go to church. Impartation is a catalyst in releasing the destinies of one life. A lot of us, we're just wandering around. Been in church all of our life. We cannot find our purpose. We cannot find our destiny because you think that singing in the choir and wearing white gloves and being an usher and giving a dollar is enough. 1 Corinthians 11, I want you all to read that. Okay, let's look at the first verse. It says, "Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ." 2, "Now I praise you, brethren," this is Paul, "that ye remember me in all things and keep the ordinances as I delivered them to you." What ordinances? Don't pastor and you don't know what even the two ordinances of the church. It is what? Baptism and the Holy Communion. "But I would have you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is the man." I didn't say women was not supposed to pastor or lead, but the head of that woman ought to be a man. And the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonored his head. I want to touch on that. When you all see us wearing a Zoo Kettle or the big thing we wear, those are not hats. Those are not head covers. Those are spiritual. Those of you wearing garments up and down the streets, those garments should never be in the streets, because they are set aside. I got Bishop Lee Johnson on here. So the Zoo Kettle is not a hat. It is symbolic. The reason we wear the Zoo Kettle, the reason we wear the mitre. But then again, it says, every woman praying or prophesied with her head uncovered, dishonored her head. And back in the day, that women covered their heads. Back in the old Church of God in Christ, the good old, they wore the big nice hats and head coverings and what have you. "For that is even as one," okay, "for that is even as one as if she were shaven." In other words, a woman should not shave her head. The sixth verse, it says, "For if the woman be not covered, let her also be shorn." Or your hair cut. That's what that shorn mean. "But if it be a shame for a woman to be shorn or shaven, then let her be covered." Which we don't follow these principles now. I understand. Y'all say we in a new dimension, we in a new time. Okay, all right. So verse 7 says, "For a man indeed ought not to cover his head." I'm talking about with a hat, not a Zoo Kettle, not these spiritual coverings, not a mitre. But with a man don't wear, and we don't enforce nothing, and this is in the church, Men are wearing hats and caps. That's disrespectful to the pastor, to the church, and to the women. When I was a little boy, mama told me to take off hat in the house before I come in the house. For as much as he is the image and the glory of God, but the woman is the glory of the man. Verse 8, for the man is not of the woman, but the woman of the man. That's why it's difficult for me to be led by a woman. I didn't say it was wrong, but because God created man.